Okay, so welcome to the science review. This is a roundabout science review number 4. What I do is I watch videos throughout the week after work, and I just jot down the interesting parts of the video, and I pass it on as education, hoping that it'll bring more attention to what scientists are trying to work out at the moment. Okay, the first video, and I highly recommend watching this video, is Lawrence Krauss, A Universe from Nothing, Why There Is Something Rather Than Nothing. The channel is The Science Foundation. I like to think of scientists as mechanics. There's a fairly huge problem they're working on at the moment, which is the small microscopic, even smaller world. There's a lot of laws that are different from the big world, such as the world we live in, and really just a big bunch of mechanics trying to work out sort of how to fix it, how to understand it. The speaker is Lawrence Krauss. What I'd like to show now, if I may, we'll start off with Lawrence Krauss talking about Hubble finding more than just one galaxy, our galaxy, to 400 billion galaxies known now.
A great example. Hubble did many things, and one of the first things he did, which is somewhat peripheral to the rest of the stuff, but it's probably relevant to give you the context. In 1925, he used the Mount Wilson telescope to do something remarkable. In 1925, our universe consisted of one galaxy, our Milky Way galaxy. That was it. Surrounded by a vast eternal darkness. And there was a big debate. When you looked through telescopes at the time, you saw these fuzzy things in our galaxy, and they were called nebulae, which is Greek for fuzzy thing. And there was a big debate what they were. With the Mount Wilson telescope, Hubble was able to show that they were, in fact, not just fuzzy things, but other island universes, other galaxies. And we now know there are 400 billion galaxies, almost, in our observable universe. 400 billion in a single human lifetime. 87 years ago, we knew of one.
And now he goes on to talk about observing a expanding universe.
Let me create a two-dimensional universe, which is easy to see from the outside. I've created this two-dimensional universe, and I have these galaxies at normal intervals here, regular intervals, and a region of that, this is just a region of the universe. Then I look at it at a later time, and it's bigger. You can see it's bigger because you're outside of it. When you're outside of it, it's easy to see the universe is expanded. But what would you see if you were in that universe? Well, very simple. Just pick a galaxy, any galaxy, say that one. And I just want to superimpose this image on top of this one, placing this galaxy on top of itself. And what would you see? You'd see exactly what Hubble saw. Every galaxy is moving away from you. Those that are twice as far away are moving twice as fast, three times as far away are moving three times as fast. And it doesn't matter what galaxy you pick. Any galaxy, you see exactly the same.
Here Mr. Krauss talks about whether or not our universe is open, closed, or flat.
If I look far enough in that direction, I see the back of my head. Like it go around the universe and come back. But more importantly, for a closed universe, it turns out full of matter, the universe will expand, stop, and contract again. For an open universe full of matter, it'll go on expanding forever. And a flat universe is just the boundary between the two. It'll go on expanding and slow down and never quite stop.
Now talking about matter and gravity, bending light.
You never get it published in science, okay? It was definitely an easier time. Now the author, of course, had some credentials. The author was Albert Einstein. But Einstein published his result of a calculation that he thought was incredibly unimportant. The result was that he'd already shown, in fact it was one of the triumphs of general relativity, that space is curved and light bends around massive objects. But he reasoned that if you have a very massive object and a light source behind it, the light rays can bend around on either side and come back and be focused, and the matter can act like a lens. Space can act like a lens.
Next, Mr. Krauss will show a picture of how a massive object can bend light. This is a very interesting observation and point he makes, and also a very interesting picture.
Sure, of the phenomena that Einstein said would never be observable. This is a picture, for those who can see it, of a cluster of galaxies. Clusters are the largest bound objects in the universe. They contain hundreds of galaxies or tens of millions of light years across, and anything that can fall into anything will fall into a cluster of galaxies. So if you can weigh the clusters, you can weigh the universe. And this is a Hubble Space Telescope picture, and it's beautiful because every dot in this picture is a galaxy, not a star. This cluster is 5 billion light years away. That means the light from those stars left 5 billion years ago, before our sun formed.
5 billion years ago.
But it also means many of those stars no longer exist. And by the way, civilizations around those stars probably no longer exist. Each of these galaxies contains 100 billion stars, and potentially many long-lost civilizations that we'll never know about. Every time I look at a picture like this, I get inspired. But that's not the purpose of this particular picture, but it is fascinating. We can weigh this cluster, because you don't have to be a rocket scientist, for those that can see it, to see there's these weird little blue things. And those blue things are multiple images of a single galaxy.
That's one single galaxy.
5 billion light years behind that cluster.
Behind the cluster.
10 billion light years away from us. Magnified by the cluster.
So what he said then was, these blue areas here are actually a galaxy 5 billion years behind this cluster here. And this the gravity of this cluster is magnifying these images of the galaxy. The combined mass and gravity of this is magnifying these images of the same galaxy. Here he makes the point that there's more in the universe that we can see and detect.
Get this picture, and this is a picture of where the mass is in the system. The spikes are where the galaxies are. But what you notice is this huge mountain of mass where the galaxies aren't. 40 times as much mass exists in this cluster as can be accounted for by all the light and all the stars and all the galaxies. And physicists, because they're so inventive, call this stuff dark matter.
So here he's got a picture of the microwave background. This is when we look out into space, or when scientists look out into space and they observe the cosmic microwave background, the very first thing they can see is this. And just note that this picture matches most this picture, and this picture is for a flat universe.
They look on this picture. Well, we could compare this picture, this is a different false color image, to universes we create on a computer. And here are how big the lump should be if the universe is closed, and they should be this big, but these are bigger than these lumps. And here, if the universe is open, they should be this big as these little blue things here, but these are smaller than these lumps, but just like Goldilocks. If the universe is flat, it's just right. And we now know to an accuracy of 1% that the universe is indeed flat.
Here he talks about the properties of empty space.
Not in this country. So when you put quantum mechanics and relativity together, empty space ain't so empty. In fact, it's a boiling, bubbling brew of virtual particles. And here it is in animation. This was actually shown at the Nobel Prize ceremonies a few years ago. A friend of mine won the Nobel Prize for the theory that allowed you to predict this. This is what space looks like inside of every proton in your body. We now know that empty space is a boiling, bubbling brew of virtual particles that pop in and out of existence in a timescale so short you can't measure them.
And here he talks about how the universe could possibly be made out of nothing.
It didn't have to be that way. It didn't have to be that way, but it is. So that's very suggestive, and I want to now, in the closing 2 or 3 hours, talk to you about what the implications are. So, I want to talk to you about making a universe from nothing. And of course I have to redefine nothing. The first kind of nothing I want to talk about is the kind of nothing of the classical philosophers in the Bible. An eternal, dark, empty void, which would have been good enough for theologians, until I showed them that something could come from it. That nothing, empty space, is quite simple to show something can come from it. Something will always come from that kind of empty space, because nothing is unstable. Because I've already told you that empty space ain't so empty. It's full of these virtual particles popping in and out of existence. No real particles. But it's a complicated thing. Now, virtual particles are not something. So how can you create something from nothing? Well, when you add gravity to the mix, then you can create something. You see, because the virtual particles pop in and out of existence and have to go back because they take energy, and if they have energy, positive energy, they have to disappear before you can measure them, otherwise you're violating energy conservation. But when you add gravity to the mix, you can create particles that have positive energy due to their motion, but if they're in a strong enough gravitational field, there's negative energy, and their total energy can be zero. And in that case, you can create them with impunity.
Here Mr. Krauss talks about small-scale mechanics or subatomic scale.
What the bleep do you know, or other nonsense, you don't hear that. But quantum mechanics is really crazy. And it says that on a subatomic level, indeed, elementary particles are doing many different things at the same time. Electrons, which act like they're spinning, are spinning not just in one direction, but all directions at the same time. We measure them, we find out they were spinning in one direction. But before we measured them, they were spinning in all directions at the same time, and we can show that that's the case. So it really is crazy, but it tells us that in some sense, on the small scales, anything that can happen is happening, and all possibilities are being explored at the same time. So that's true at a microscopic level.
And the strangeness of the universe
is that in spite of our limitations, that our intuitive understanding isn't sufficient to grasp it, we nevertheless have been able to be dragged kicking and screaming slowly by the universe itself to realize the way it really is, even if it's stranger than we could have ever imagined. And in fact, that's the real moral, is that the universe is stranger than we could have ever imagined. Every time we open up a new window on the universe, we're surprised, which is why we have to keep looking. If we just did this all in a closed room, we would never come up with a universe that's as interesting as the one we actually live in. And that's why physics is interesting and philosophy isn't.
His book's called A Universe from Nothing, and no doubt it'd be very good reading. Same as the previous video, this is another book, Quantum Man. So Lawrence Krauss, Quantum Man. Richard Feynman's Life in Science. And the channel is The Science Foundation. Lawrence Krauss looks up to Richard Feynman's work. He's no longer with us anymore, apparently, Richard Feynman, but he had a big influence on Lawrence Krauss. I'd just like to say that I'm not a scientist, but I'm somebody that does have an interest in science and science theory. Here, Mr. Krauss talks about light's ability to work out the path of least time between A and B. So if it's going from A to B, it's able to work out the path of least time and not the shortest distance.
And a vertical in the water. And you can calculate all the different paths that light will take, and you will find the path it takes, by Snell's law, is the path that takes the least time. So light figures it out and takes the path of least time. Well, it doesn't, but it behaves as if it does. And that's a fascinating thing. And one of the things I'm sure that fascinated Feynman about it is he was fascinated, as am I, by the fact that you can express many physical laws, ways that seem totally different, each one revealing something different about nature.
And he goes on to talk about the mirage.
Amazing fact. Now, in fact, in Arizona, if you drive there, you may see a mirage. And this effect is responsible for mirages. I couldn't resist explaining mirages for those who have never seen them. So, a mirage, of course, when you look at the street, you look down at a hot highway way ahead of you and you see what looks like a puddle. Or if you're in the desert walking, you see what looks like water. And the reason is, what's happening is the light comes from the sky where it's blue and comes down, and it might just hit the ground, but it doesn't because if it's very hot, there are many layers of air above the ground. And at each layer, it bends. And it bends outward because the air is hottest near the ground and less dense. When it goes from more dense to less dense, it bends outward. And so it bends outward until it finally makes a return path and comes up to your eye. So you're looking down on the ground and you're seeing light that comes from the sky. That's how we normally think. But in fact, you can understand it using this principle of least time, because the light has two choices. It can come from the sky directly to your eye, making a straight line through the air. But this air up here is cold, and light travels slower in cold air. So what the light instead decides to do is go down and hang around as long as it can in the hot air and then come back up to your eye.
Here he talks about the famous double slit experiment.
What happens when you throw, not baseballs, but electrons at this? You throw electrons at this wall, and the electrons are particles, just like those balls. But what do you see when the electrons go through these slits? You see a pattern that looks identical to the pattern of those waves. Now, I'm not trying to argue that electrons are waves here. I'm trying to argue that this is crazy, because electrons are particles. And you can say, this is so crazy, because what it means is the electron acts like it's going through both slits at the same time, because that's what a wave does. But electrons are particles, so it goes through one slit or another. And I can prove it. I can shine a light on these slits, and when each electron goes through, I can say, which slit did it go through? And indeed, if I do that, and I send electrons in one by one, and I shine a light on them, each electron will be observed to go through only one slit or the other. And I can say, aha, I proved it. The electron only went through one slit. But then I turn around, and the pattern has changed. The pattern looks like this pattern, with two spots, not a whole series of spots. So if I look at the electron during the process and determine which slit it goes through, the pattern is different than if I don't look at the electron. I built a huge plant in Oak Ridge, Tennessee, and then determine what the nuclear physics was of these things that weren't even known. I mean, nowadays it would take more than 3 years to get the environmental permit to build the plant in Oak Ridge, Tennessee. But in 3 years, by mobilizing the best minds in the world that were available, the United States did that. And Feynman...
Here, Mr. Krauss talks about Feynman and how he worked things out, and that was to simply look at a problem he wanted to solve from every single angle he could.
Feynman wanted you to... The reason I concentrated on a science, and the reason I hope this is a book that Feynman would have wanted, is to understand a science. I think the reason... In fact, he says it many times. The reason he got to these things is he just tried every different possibility. And that's the point. He worked endlessly and tirelessly trying every different possibility he could come up with until he found one that worked. What made him unique in that regard is not just his tireless ability to try all those things, but most people couldn't perform every calculation, couldn't try every possibility. But no matter what possibility existed, he was capable of exploring it. And that's how the way he says in his Nobel Prize speech is, I just tried to understand the theory from every different way I could try. And each way would work in a different way, and each way would give me insight in a different context. Bell's law, and he even talked about this. Well, if you think about it, in one sense, it tells you about the property of materials, if you understand the refraction of the property of materials. If you think about how light bends, it tells you about electromagnetic waves. If you think about the principle of least action, it tells you about something about space and time. They all give the same answers, but each one illuminates a different facet of the physical world. So my impression, and Feynman's certainly explanation of his success, was that he just tried to understand something from many different ways.
The next video is A Matter of Time, full program, World Science Festival. Here Max Tedmark talks about time and the properties of time, and he refers to a DVD, that all the DVD there is there at the same time. So the entire movie is there, and as you go through it, it's simply different segments of time. So as you watch the DVD, you simply you experience all the segments of time, or the film clips. Or another way to put it, he talks about Einstein's idea of space-time as moments.
Space-time, where time is just the fourth dimension and nothing is ever happening. The past, the present, the future is in there. You know, so if our life is a movie, then space-time is the entire DVD.
And you can travel within any of that time, forward, backward? If you slice it up, can you get to all the slices?
Well, Einstein would say that the space-time is just static, like a beautiful crystal you can have in your filing cabinet or something. The DVD is not changing, right? It's right. Wrong to say that the actor in the DVD, who's the hero, is traveling through the DVD. It's all there. And there are just these different moments in the actor's life that are in different places of a space-time.
Here, Paul Davies talks about how moments in time can be different depending on the speed at which you're traveling.
Intervals of time can be different depending on where you are and how you're moving, as I was explaining. So when I say intervals of time, between two fixed events, and the classic example that everybody likes to talk about is called the twins effect, and sometimes called the twins paradox. It's not paradoxical. So supposing you and I were twins, so obviously born on the same day, same age, I go off in a rocket ship very close to the speed of light, and I go for, say, 2 years, and when I get back, I find you're 20 years older. I've been moved so close to the speed of light, this time dilation has done that. So I've in effect leapt 18 years into your future. And people want to say, well, who is right? Well, we're both right. My time and your time are not the same. You stayed at home, I went in the rocket ship. We're both correct. The two end events, my departure and my return, we agree on. They're fixed events, but the interval of time between them depends on how you're moving. And we can measure this stuff, no problem. It's measured every day. We're going to hear a bit more about it, but most obviously with the global positioning system.
Now, one point that I'd like to make is that this planet is actually travelling, and yet when we look out into space, we find that everything is moving away from us at the same speed. So if everything is moving away from us at the same speed, and we're travelling at a very fast rate, the planet, then what direction are we travelling in? And what is the exact place, the origin of the Big Bang? Where in space did it happen? If there was a Big Bang, if we looked in one direction, there'd be objects moving towards us. And if we looked out in the opposite direction, objects should be moving away from us. Here, Craig Callender talks about an experiment which was done. Okay, so you get two synchronized watches. You put them up in two aeroplanes. The aeroplanes are up in the sky here. One goes this way, one goes that way. And they come back, they compare the clocks, and they're different when moving away from each other at the same speed.
If you move faster and faster close to the speed of light and time slows down a bit, you can perform an experiment where you have a clock that's standing still and a clock that's moving really fast and see if they keep the same time. And that has been done.
That's right. That was what was done, was, you know, synchronize the ones on the planes to the one on the Earth, send the planes off in different directions, come back, and then they're not synchronized anymore.
The clocks don't measure the same time anymore.
No.
Here, Mr. Max Tedmark makes the observation that atoms travel at half speed at the edge of a black hole.
What's the evidence? Well, we've actually seen clocks run slowed down by black holes, because we heard from Paul that we can think of even atoms as clocks, where instead of the pendulum on Grandpa's clock, it's the frequency with which things are vibrating in the clock. And this is a really cool simulation that my colleague Ben Bromley made of how the iron atoms slow down near a black hole, and when they slow down, they emit light at a slower frequency, which looks red, as you can see here. And the best measurements we have of the spectra of these so-called iron K-alpha lines confirm this, and show direct evidence that the atoms near black holes have their time going at only half the speed.
So in this clip we can see that a galaxy is moving away from us, I think at the speed of light, and a galaxy supernova goes off, and we observe it slowly because of the amount of time that it takes to get to us because the galaxy is moving away.
Here we have a galaxy moving away from us near the speed of light, and we see a supernova go off, boom! You can see a flash going off there. For a brief moment, the supernova outshines all the other stars in the galaxy. We see it rise, and we see it fade in a very interesting regular way, which was recently used to win the Nobel Prize in Physics. And the cool thing is that when you look at supernovae, they're really far away, traveling away near the speed of light. You see them blowing up, not poof, but they blow up in slow motion. You can really see the time has slowed down.
Time has slowed down.
It's not like David Wineland's atomic clock where you need to measure 17 decimal places.
Next, Mr. Max Tedmark talks about the microwave background, which is what scientists observe when they look furthest out into space. I believe that this is a bit of a misrepresentation of the cosmic microwave background, because what's actually happening is that's like a ball, and we would be inside in the middle of that, looking out outside. So we're actually outside of the cosmic microwave background. It shouldn't really be a ball. It should be a half cup with the Earth observing all the different points. Here you can see that there's the eye, and it'll turn around. You can see no matter what direction we look in, we see this cosmic microwave background. It's funny how we're right in the middle of the background and not sort of here looking there. and it's closer here than there, where it's further out. I suppose what I'm trying to say is that it's a sort of a little bit too lucky that we're right in the middle of this microwave background. So we'll see what he has to say.
Looks to us as if beyond all these galaxies is a wall of glowing hydrogen plasma. And next slide, please. We, of course, see that in whatever direction we look. So the way it appears to us humans is as though we're actually surrounded by a giant plasma screen. This is the so-called microwave background radiation. And this was on the front page of the New York Times just the other month, the Planck satellite image, and put it in here, the way
that's we actually... That's not the Earth, that's the
universe. We're in the middle of this, and what you're looking at, this ball, is the spherical region from which light has had time to get here so far.
That's on the outside of that thing? No.
If we wait this another bit, for example, neutrinos, and even gravitational waves, ripples in the very fabric of space-time, and the next sensational big thing in cosmology will be if we detect these gravitational waves from 10 to the power minus 34 seconds after our Big Bang. If this will happen, if the inflation theory is the correct answer for what happened early on,
right.
And if it happened in the simplest possible way, and if it happens, it'll definitely be all over the Science Friday, you know,
right.
in a year or two.
Here, Paul Davies talks about the passing of time, or moments in time, and he refers to the DVD model where all the time is there, and you simply pan through all the moments.
Hermann Weyl expressed it very well. Time does not pass, it merely is. And so we're back to this whole issue about the DVD, about block time, as is the technical term. We have space-time, it's just there. I like to call it the timescape. We have the landscape, you can unfurl a map that represents the landscape in the same way we've got the timescape. Everything is there. You have all events for all of space-time simply there. I don't think anybody claims that's an illusion. So measuring an interval with clocks between two events is real.
Okay.
But the question is, what about this impression that we all have in daily life that time is flowing. Or moving? And
you have a video of it,
and we do. And I think it's an illusion, but I'd like to be persuaded otherwise. And this is my favourite analogy. And so, now everyone has had the same experience. You spin around like that and stop. You have this overwhelming impression that the universe is rotating. Okay, you feel it's this dizziness. Everything's going around when you stop. But you can look at a spot on the wall and you can see, of course, it's not rotating. You can, your observation show it can't be rotating. It feels in your head like it is rotating.
For a lot of the video, Paul Davies, Max Tedmark, Tim Moldlin and Craig Callender really don't come to any firm agreement on the properties of time. Tim Moldlin, he says it himself, he can make a living out of sticking to the conventional way of science thinking, or call the standard model, and he's able to put bread on the table that way. That's fine, and he, in the long run, he might be correct, he may be incorrect. Time will tell on the true properties of time.